بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا حبيبنا وطبيب نفوسنا أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وعلى الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين مظلومين، سيما بقية الله العظم، بقية الله خير لكم إن كنتم مؤمنين، ولعنة الداعم على أعدائهم وغاصب حقوقهم ومنكر فضائلهم أجمعين من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين. أما بعد، فقد قال الله تعالى في محكم كتابه المجيد: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، وقضى ربك ألا تعبدوا إلا إياه وبالوالدين إحسانا، صدق الله العلي العظيم. السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. عظم الله أجورنا وأجوركم. The eighth night of the month of Muharram, dedicated to the standard bearer Abu al-Fadl Abbas alayhi salam. A lot to be discussed in regards to his personality. The limited time that is allotted, in which we tend to focus just upon the masaib of his. Indeed, as he was the desire of Amir al-Mu'mineen, because after the shahadat of Siddiqah Kubra, Hazrat Amir asked Ibn Aqil to find a lady who could bear a child who would be a supporter and helper for Imam Hussein alayhi salam. The event of Karbala was something that was already in knowledge of the Prophet, of Amir al-Mu'mineen, of Siddiqah Kubra and Ahl Bayt. All of them, they tried their level best to prepare for this event. The helpers of this event, the children, the youth, and the Imam himself, and each and every activity of that day also contributed towards making this martyrdom, making this event a success, so that it remains a source of understanding the truth till the day of judgment. Because it was clear at the birth of Imam Hussein, it was clear at the birth of Abu al-Fazl, where Amir al-Mu'mineen kisses the hands of Abu al-Fazl and cries. And he says that these are the hands which will be severed on the day of Ashura. Each and every soul played its perfect role for making this event a success. And perhaps due to this very reason, we do not find any of the Imams after Imam Hussein alayhi salam went the path, the route which Imam Hussein alayhi salam took, because it has already fulfilled what it was required for humanity to be guided, for humanity to be humanity by the sacrifice of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. As we are looking at the role of faith in life, we pointed out to the importance of understanding the existence of man from the point of view of higher principles, where he is reflecting the Jalal and Jamal of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Perhaps some might think that we have gone off the theme or off the mawzu, But just to recap, why did we started discussing the reality of human being was in regards to understand that if we have iman, if we believe that an insan is in the image of God and he is reflecting the divine qualities of God, then he will come to terms to understand these divine qualities within himself and around him. And through this, he will always be in the presence of faith. Through this, he will always be in the presence of God, by which it would help him to be in the state of equilibrium, to be in the state of peace, to be in the state of Islam. As we said, Islam is really means equilibrium and balance. That's what Islam means. That Islam is a name of peace and balance. A peace is only where there is balance. So therefore, when a person understands one's wujud, one's existence, that he is manifestating the jalal and the jamal of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and marriage is that institution which reflects the perfect union of God, then he would approach marriage in this fashion. That it is nothing but a medium, a vehicle through which he will reach God. When that sexual act itself is considered as sacred for him, then he would not shy away, or he would not be frowning upon certain of the du'as that exist that acquire and seeks Hauralain, for instance, that we ask in the du'as. So if this act is an act of guilt, is this act is a negative act, then why are you seeking this in the hereafter? Because this act itself is a pure act, is a sacred act. Then if there is any sanctity in this act, that is why, and then only it will be sanctity in the hereafter. If there is no sanctity in this dunya, what worth is this act in the hereafter? So therefore, if one approaches this act itself from a point of view of that iman, from that imani perspective, that this act is an act which symbolizes the union, symbolizes that very unity in multiplicity, then only the marriage will last, then only the divorce rate will fall. How can it be so that a husband will not respect the very source of his future, which is the wife through which his generation continues? The children, his own children, and that very wife becomes the very place where heaven lies at the feet of the mother. How can it be possible that there be no respect for the wife, where the feet becomes the heaven for his children, where she becomes the source for the continuation of his name, and his children where it becomes the source for the increase of his daraja, even if he doesn't live in this dunya. So therefore, the relationship that is based, that is complementary, a relationship that really assists and help each other to understand God more. So that's what marriage is all about. That is the reality of marriage. Now, as we move along with this very important realities, such as insan, such as marriage, then we are faced with another phenomena, and that is the phenomena of parenthood. That is the phenomena and reality of parents, and how one should really approach this reality. Who are parents, and what are our responsibility? If we have iman, if we have faith, if we have belief, how shall we deal with this reality? As we had mentioned earlier, you know, the reality of du'as, I'll just mention in the margin, as this becomes the reference and source for us to really look into what is the reality of parents. See, dua, as we said earlier, is nothing but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking through the speech of an insan-e-kamil. That's what dua is. All the duas that we have, particularly of Masumeen alayhimus salam, the imams, they reach to a state of fana. They reach to a state of annihilation. And when they reach that state of kamal and perfection and annihilation, God speaks through them. So when the imam is contemplating, is trying to analyze that what is his responsibility, in front of the parents, then that becomes the dua of parents of Imam Sajjad alayhi salam. Then one would approach that dua and reflect, and this is how am I supposed to behave? So that is, see, for us, duas are not just seeking, are not just duas, are not just, as they say, laqlaqe zaban, as it just should be on the tongue and we are really asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for things. But dua is something that we really have to act upon them. So when the imam is contemplating, is doing that tadabbur wa tafakkur in regards to this divine reality which are parents, then Allah speaks to him. Then Allah speaks through him to point out that this is how you are supposed to behave, O Sajjad. So when we reflect in that dua, we will find a methodology by which or through which we serve and we behave vis-a-vis parents, in front of parents. So now what about the Quran? As the Quran says, وَقَدَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُ إِلَّا إِيَّا Surah Isra, and this is coming after when? These verses are after where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about Tawheed, and He says that those who believe in that oneness of God, those who bear witness that, then they are considered as mu'min. Now, this verse needs to be understood through what we have said. We said heart is Iman and the body is Islam. So therefore, even believing on that outward level was considered as Iman. Believing on, in depth level by the heart is also considered as Iman. There are different darajat that we have talked about. So here as well in the verse, it points out to those who bear witness, those who believe in the Tawheed, they are considered as Mu'min. And then after that, these verses come about. Another point which I really wanted to mention, which would help us to comprehend and understand the previous two nights discussion, and that is where we said, when we bear witness, what do we call that? That kalima, that pronouncement. That pronouncement is called shahada, is bearing witness, is shahada. Shahada means what? Witness means what? To see. Right? That's what it means. So La ilaha illallah when we are saying, and Muhammad Rasulullah, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. That means that we are seeing there is no God but God, and the Rasul, and Muhammad is the Rasul, is the messenger of God, right? We are seeing, we are bearing witness. Now, the reality of bearing witness, seeing, as we said earlier, is nothing but within the creation itself. Man is mahjub, man is veiled from seeing the Zat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then man would see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that relationship of male and female, that reflection of the passivity of the Jamal of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or within himself, or within the creation. So he's seeing, he's bearing witness. So these realities which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he himself calls as ayat, the creation of male and female and marriage as well, considered as azwaj, considered as these are the signs and ayat in which for you to reflect. So when these are the ayat of what? Ayat of haqq, ayat of reality, or ayat of the asma ilahi. So when I am seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this relationship, then I am true to this pronouncement of la ilaha illallah. Because I cannot see the Zat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So why it is called Shahada? Why it is called witnessing? So if I could see that those divine asma, those divine names and the relationship that exists in that, then I'm true to, then I'm a true Muslim. Then when I bear witness, when I give Shahada, then that is a truthful one. So now in regards to the parents as well, after mentioning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who believes in Tawheed, he's a mu'min, then he talks about, parents and the importance of it. If you look at it, Allah is without any condition saying that you gotta be nice, you have to do ahsan to the parents. But prior to that, he says that do not worship anyone but Allah and be kind to the parents. So the command of do not worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala but anybody, in the same vertical reality, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala discloses, unfolds another reality, that is be kind to the parents. So it is that command form while mentioning to us that do not worship anyone but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning be kind to the parents. So it points without any condition, whether they be Muslim or whether they be mushrik, there's nothing of that accord, that if they are mushrik, so that you do not serve them, you do not be kind to them. Even if they are not, you have to be kind towards them. And if you look at the amount of traditions that we have, that being kind to the parents is more than salat, is more than fasting, is more than hajj, is more than jihad, in terms of the tradition. Look at this tradition which comes from our sixth Imam, Imam Jafar al-Sadiq alayhi salam. He says the greatest of all amal is the amal, is an act where a person performs salat on time, number one. Number two is a person carries out kindness towards the parents. And number three is jihad fi sabilillah. So the kindness to the parents is included in the act of prayer, in the act of jihad. So it is praying on time, being kind to parents, and jihad. So it is that important. Now, in another hadith that we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have not provided a leeway, an escape from three things. And these are very important. If a person is a mu'min, he will bring this in his life. That's why we are discussing this, the role of iman in our life, in our faith. Then he says that three things, and they are number one, fulfillment of the amanat, of the trust that has been given to us. Fulfillment of that. Whether this be vis-a-vis a person who is a good person or a bad person. If a person have an amanat even of a, you know, who is not a good person, who is a mushrik, for example, still he has to fulfill the amanat. And that's why Prophet is known as Amin, isn't it so? Then number two is fulfillment of vow, of ahad, of a promise that is made. Whether that be made to a mushrik, to a Muslim or a non-Muslim, to a person who is good or bad, he has to fulfill his promise. And number three is being kind to parents. There is no escape from these three things. Allah will hold accountable to a person who does not fulfill the amanat, who does not fulfill the promise, and who is not kind to parents. And the hadith continues, and the Imam says that in all of these three, one of them, which is being kind to parents, is even after they are not in this dunya. If they be not in this dunya, and if they have died, may Allah have, you know, mercy upon all of those parents who are not in this world, of all of the mu'minin and mu'minat. Even if they are not in this dunya, be kind to them, visit them. In another hadith, it says that there are certain times in which one could be kind to parents. That is on the day of Eid, that is on the day of Friday, that he should go and visit the grave of parents, which becomes the source of forgiveness for themselves. It's an act which is carried out by him to recite Fatiha, to recite Dua, or to give charity for the parents, but in reality he is forgiven. That is the beauty of the act or doing good towards parents, that he is included in that great act. Kindness to the parents, Salat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. In another tradition we find, this is very amazing tradition, Ruya an awwala ma. It has been, there's a riwayat that it says that what is returned, the first thing upon the Lohi Mahfuz, is that katabahu Allah fi Lohi Mahfuz, the first thing that is written on the Lohi Mahfuz is do not do shirk. And then right after that it is returned that whosoever parents is radi, is pleased with the child, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is radi and pleased with that child. So the ridayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is dependent upon the ridayat of the children, of the sons and daughters of that person. So he, the same way as he is pointing out to the that do not worship anyone but Allah and be kind to parents in the same command. So it's a vertical reality which they share with God. It is just a similar reality as we say Atiullah wa Atiur Rasul wa Ulil Amr Minkum. It's a vertical reality. Serving and attending and doing ita'at to the Ulil Amr is really doing ita'at to the Rasul and doing ita'at to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As it says that izzatu lillah wa li rasulihi wa lil mu'mineen, the izzat and honor belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rasul and also mu'mineen. So when I am being respectful to a mu'min, in reality this is returning back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This honor is of Allah. When we respect each other, it is respect of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-izzatu lillah, because that izzah, that honor is an abstract reality. So when I'm doing izzat of a mu'min, in reality I'm doing izzat of Rasul and of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when the ridayat of the parents dependent, the ridayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala depends upon the pleasure of the parents. In another hadith it says that there will be special chambers in Jannah. And these special chambers is allotted only to those who are kind towards their parents in these three accords. Number one, who does infaq towards them when they are in need. You know, it is one of the things that we tend to unfortunately forget, that the parents spend all of their savings and all of their what they have in order to in the upbringing of the child, so that they go to the best school, so that they study. And then once they reach to an age where they are independent, where they are working, where they are, you know, they have finished their education, it doesn't occur to them that what they are earning, something part of it should be given to the parents. Although they might not need it in the first place, but still, you know, something should be given. That really brings that joy to the hearts of the parents if it is given. You know, if that person is in that state and he could, you know, that he should do that. This doesn't really occur. You know, perhaps those who are living in the East, maybe, but in the West at all. You know, I spoke to a young lad who was a doctor, and then eventually I mentioned this point. He said, it never occurred to me. It never occurred to me. But this is a point. Because the youth and the upbringing, and because of the atmosphere that we live in, that we promote individualism. A person really thinks of himself and no one else. If he is working, that money belongs to him and no one else. That's it. Nobody have the share in it. Even like we say in regards to when there is husband and wife, the same thing. When the wife is earning, it's hers. It's, you know, they don't like to share with that. The same applies for, you know, the husband, for instance. So therefore, number one, he says, when a person does infaq to the parents, number two, he compromises for the parents. These special chambers are for those individuals who does infaq, who compromises towards the parents, and who does kindness, who are kind towards the parents, and who do not bring any sorrow to the heart of the parents. These chambers are for them. So much emphasis that regards to being kind, in regards to our behavior, in regards to the rights that the parents have. There is the shade on the day of Qiyamah of the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And those who are kind towards their parents, they will be able to utilize the shade. They would be under the shade of this throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, according to the tradition that comes from Imam Sadiq alayhi salam. So it is a divine reality. It is a reflection of the authority, and it is the reflection of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala within. When we look at, you know, you might have heard a lot of this, that when a daughter is born, they say it's mercy of God. When a son is given, it says it's a ni'mat from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is sawal against the ni'mat, and there is, you know, no sawal against the mercy. It is quite famous among us. Now, in a hadith, perhaps this could be the tradition where he says that father is considered as the ni'mat. The fourth imam says, your father is the ni'mat. And therefore, whenever you come about or whenever you achieve and receive a ni'mat, you should do shukr to Allah and to your father, that it is because of him you've been provided this ni'mat. If it wasn't for him, you will not be in this dunya. He has become the source. And mother is considered as that mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in many traditions, we tend to find that mother have an awlawiyat, have a priority. And the Prophet have said that when you are praying a mustahab prayer, and if your mother calls you, break the prayer and go to your mother. But we do not find in regards to the father. Musa ibn Imran, when communicating to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inquires that what he should do. Then he was informed about oneness of God. Then he was informed that be kind to your mother. Then he asked again. He says, be kind to your mother. Then he asked again. Then it was said that, you know, be kind to your father. So the priority, it seems to be in the direction or indicated towards the mother, because she is that symbolic earth through which the creation, you know, creation progresses and develops. You know, as we were talking about these symbols, as we were talking about, you know, woman being that passive. And if one really looks at the sciences of alchemy, you know, these metals, and one really studies that, you know, all the metals that we have are something that is revealed on this earth, that comes from the, you know, from the universe. It comes in this earth and then it develops and it grows and it changes. You know, if one really looks at the sciences of alchemy, one would find that. So whatever mineral that we have, it has come from the divine. You know, it has descended from the top to this earth. And that earth sort of, you know, trains it or comes, you know, it goes through that chemical changes and it makes it what valuable. وَأَنْزَلْنَا حَدِيدًا. The very Hajr-e Aswad itself, you know, it came onto this earth and it's a metal, it's a meteor, you know. وَأَنْزَلْنَا حَدِيدًا. We revealed hadid. You know, the iron was sent from the heaven to earth. Now, it becomes that amanat, you know. So therefore, the same way that mother becomes that place, that ground, that very earth. And then she really, as the hadith says, that she is the one who have protected you. She is the one that who have provided you, you know, who have nurtured you, who have provided you with the things that by from her own self. She would even clothe you if she is not clothed. She would feed you even if she is hungry. You know, she will take care of you in every way possible to protect you. So on these grounds, on these basis, the traditions goes or fall in the direction of the awlawiyat and the priority with the mother. Salat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. The doors of the heaven, in another hadith it says, the door of the heaven open at four times. Number one, when it rains. Number two is at a time where the door of the Kaaba opens. And number three is when the children gazes towards the parents, when they look at them, when they gaze at them. That is the time when the door of the heaven is open. So it's pointing out to, or it is encouraging us to engage us with our parents. If a person have that iman and that belief and would say that all of these divine realities that it is achieved. But at the same time, having said all of these, the Quran knows and recognizes that it is not going to be easy. We are talking about iman here, like we said. You know, anything that we want to achieve and get and receive in this dunya, cook something very, you know, delicious, it requires a lot of pains and difficulties, isn't it? So it's the same, we are talking about iman here. To after reaching to that age where one have the strength, where one have that intellectual capacity, where one believes that his will and he is strong to behave in the fashion the way the riwayat and the traditions and the ayat are saying, it becomes difficult. You know, as it says that, do not even, you know, أو كلاهما, when both of them, فلا تقل لهما أف, do not even utter أف. When we look at the meaning of this أف, there are different meanings. You know, some says that it is that sort of dirt or dust that is hidden in the nails, very little, very something. You know, it is shirk, you know, it's something that is, you know, that comes on your clothes that you just, you know, wipes it, or you just, you know, kind of like get rid of it very quickly. So that's like the meanings of uff. You know, it's like saying, ah, you know. So you are not even supposed to say that to your parents. To that extent, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the ayah of the Quran. It is not hadith. So it has to be something very important that the Quran is pointing out to that you do not behave in this fashion with your parents. And as the ayah continues, and it clearly says that yes, it's at times it will be difficult for you to really, you know, function in this way, the way we are saying. But we are fully aware of your intentions. What are your niyat? Yes, your niyat might be you do not want to really behave this way. We are aware of that as well. But you gotta be in this fashion. You have to behave in this fashion when it comes to your parents. See, the more the person serves, the more the person does ahsan and kindness, the more the person is subservient and subdue and submit to the parents, the more he will be raised in terms of his spirituality, in terms of his even worldly fame, if you want to call. You know, he will be known, he will be recognized. You know, it goes together. Now, whether that be in this dunya, whether that be in the hereafter. But when we look at the most of the, you know, evidences in history, whether it be in the plains of Karbala, whether it be, you know, in a very typical sort of secular system as well, those who have served their elders, those who have served their parents, they've been recognized. As we are approaching to the time where in which we get the sawab, in which we perform the ibadat of the masaib of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, tonight is the night of the 8th, the night of Abul Fazl Abbas alayhi salam, and as we said, the more the ones who serves the will of the parents, the more he's raised. Look at Abbas, how he was in terms of fulfillment of the desires and of the will of Amirul Mumineen. They say that on the Day of Judgment, behind the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there will be heavenly lights. This happened when Imam Hussein alayhi salam on the day of Ashura was going towards the enemies, and when he asked that, O Hussein, look towards the heaven, and when he gazed the heaven, there were ranks of angels ready to help and assist him, and they are there to help you, O Hussein. But here Imam Hussein says that, yes, they are here to help me, but I have lost my Abbas. Life have no meaning for Hussein after Abbas. So Abbas, who have raised to that level because of fulfillment that vow, fulfillment of that desire, because he is the desire and dua of Amirul Mumineen. Abbas have come to this dunya to serve Hussein. There will be divine lights behind the throne. And these divine lights, when inquired, is the light of the Shuhada of Karbala. Within these divine lights, a light which seems to be like the crown of all these lights. And that crown of all these lights is the light of Abul Fadl Abbas. The status and the station and the maqam of Abul Fadl Abbas is a maqam where every shaheed envies that maqam. He wants to achieve that maqam. That is provided to Abul Fazl Abbas. Abul Fazl Abbas is the man. When he comes in the battle of Siffin, wailed, they say it is Ali who have come. The way he fights. Then Ali gallops behind Abbas and comes forward and stand next to Abbas. They say, who is this? Then Abbas is asked to unveil himself. Hada qamaru Bani Hashim. This is the radiant moon of Bani Hashim. That is the title of Abbas. Abul Fazl is the one, as they say, in the battle of Siffin, they comes to Amir and they say, oh Amirul Mumin, what a great fighter Imam Hassan Mujtaba is. But we really haven't seen Hussein fight. And nobody really have seen Imam Hussein alayhi salam fight. Because when they were discussing on the night, when the enemies were discussing on the night, they were having a meeting and they were planning a strategy. And they say that the majority of the time was left that how are we going to fight Abbas? If Hussein have Abbas, it is literally impossible for us to really defeat. It is not possible at all. So therefore, they haven't really seen Imam Hussein fight. So Imam Hussein alayhi salam wasn't really a point of concern for the enemies. The point of concern and fear was Abbas. So he says, we have seen Hassan al-Mujtaba, Imam Hassan fight, but we haven't really seen Hussein fighting. Why is it? Whenever we see that somebody is about to attack Hussein, somebody with a veil comes in front of him and him sends him to hell. Chops his head away. Wherever this young lad, this person in the veil would be, he will swiftly come and protect Hussein. He will not allow anything happen to Imam Hussein alayhi salam. And when he unveils, that was really Abul Fazl Abbas. This is Abbas, the standard bearer of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein. When that standard, when that alam was brought, when they were taken captives in Sham and Syria, when Yazid was sitting on the throne, and when that alam was brought, Yazid stood up and then he sat down again. As the alam comes closer, he stands up again. He sits down. Three times he stands up from the throne while looking at the alam of Abul Fazl. He says, oh Yazid, why are you standing up? He says, I see this alam, this standard have been attacked from all sides. It is shattered in pieces. But I see there is that fist. There is that mark that hasn't been attacked. And that is where Abul Fazl, with his fist, with his hand, was holding that standard. The hand, the standard did not fall on the ground until Abul Fazl had those hands. He was holding it tight. When the hand was severed, that's the time the standard fell. That is the alam of Abul Fazl Abbas. Abul Fazl was pleading, was requesting Imam Hussein that, oh Imam, allow me to go. The Ashab, one after the other, Habib is the friend of you. The Ashab of the friends of Amirul Mumineen being slain. It is not easy for Abbas. Allow me. Then the Shahadat of Bani Hashim, the Aun and Muhammad, Hazrat Qasim, Hazrat Ali Akbar, Imam Abul Fazl says, they are all my students, they are all younger to me, allow me. Every time when Abul Fazl comes, he says, Imam says, you are the standard bearer. You are the one who holds the alam, the spirit of alam, the spirit of Hussein, the spirit of the camps, the spirit of the ladies of Hussein is with your standard. You are the standard bearer. How can it be possible that you leave, that you go? In terms of the strength of Abul Fazl, it has been mentioned that when they ditched the trenches behind the tents so that the enemy doesn't attack from behind, and they lighted up the firewood. Here when Abul Fazl was patrolling, was controlling the tents so that the enemy doesn't attack from behind, Zuhair moves forward and he started speaking to Abbas. He started engaging Abul Fazl in a speech. Abul Fazl says, do not really engage me. I am carrying out the duty. I'm patrolling right now. Then Zuhair takes the name of Ali. Then Abul Fazl holds his rein and he stops because the name of the father is taken. He says, you know, Abbas, Ali really wanted you for this day. And at this moment, Abul Fazl stretches his feet in the stirrups and the horse bends. And while doing so, an enemy from the other side of the trenches says that, oh Hussein, you have lighted the fire in this dunya so that you burn in this fire even before you go to hell. This is how disrespectful he was. And Abul Fazl releases those stirrups, those feet. This horse jumped over the trench of fire and he fought and he killed 80 of them. And he returns back and he says, Zuhair, do not remind me of the father and do not remind me of how to protect Hussein. Allow me to patrol. And the battle continued. Abul Fazl was there as a helper to Hussein. And he says, Hussein, how can I allow you to go? Because you are the reminder of my father. And finally that hour comes that Hussein grants permission that Abul Fazl bring some water in the camps of Hussein. Abul Fazl, when he goes to get the water skin from the tents, he sees the little children calling Al-Atash, crying out, we are thirsty. And Sakina moves forward, Ruqayya moves forward and says to Abul Fazl, to the uncle, uncle, as you are going to fetch water, I have promised the little ones that water will be intense. Because it is Abul Fazl. The spirit of Hussein's camp is Abul Fazl. When Abul Fazl Abbas went to fight or went to fetch water, as they say, that as he wasn't going in order to fight, he did not use the sword, but rather he used the art of spear. He used a spear to really make his way towards the Furat, towards the Euphrates. As he marched, once again, it was not one of the typical traditional, one of the ways of engaging in the warfare, which was one-on-one, but rather it was the whole army against Abul Fazl. And now, when the whole army is against Abul Fazl, finally, after killing many, while holding the alam, while having the water skin, with the spear, he enters the Furat and he gets down from the steed and he fills the water skin. And here, when he looks at this water, takes that in his palm and he says that, oh nafs, go and fool someone else. How can I take a sip where my master is thirsty, where the children of Hussein is thirsty? Perhaps that will of Amir al-Mu'mineen might have occurred in his mind, which says that when Abul Fazl was standing at the door and Imam Ali alayhi salam was parting farewell with the children and Abul Fazl was far, and finally Amir al-Mu'mineen looks at Abul Fazl and calls him near, oh my son, come near. And he says, my will to you is that these are the children of Fatima and you are my son. He gives the hand of Hussein in the hand of Abul Fazl. And he says that, oh Abul Fazl, on the day of judgment, make me proud of your act. So here Abul Fazl, this act, that he goes to the Furat, to the Euphrates, the water is there, he is thirsty, but just because his master is thirsty, the children of Hussein is thirsty, he does not take a sip of water. He fills the water skin and he goes on to the mount, he rides the horse back. Now he's returning back. And Imam Hussein from far witnessing, looking at what is with the alam, what is with the standard. As he sees that alam is about to fall, is moving left and right, is bending down, Hussein falls onto the ground. And then the children are also engaged in looking at the alam as it's coming closer and closer. Their hopes are increasing that the water is reaching to the tent. And that hour occurs when a person hiding behind a tree moves forward and severs the hand of Abul Fazl. And he takes the water skin in his left hand and he says, Wallahu in qata'atu yamini yuha'imu. If you even cut my right hand, I will be the hami of my deen, of my religion, and I will be the protector of my imam. And when he takes the water skin in his left hand, as the hand is completely severed, then another person attacks the left hand, and that is completely severed as well. Now he holds the water skin in his mouth. And now still his all desire is somehow this water reaches the tents of Hussein, as he has promised. But when they targeted the arrow, when they targeted the water skin, as it pierces and another arrow hits the eye of Abul Fazl Abbas, that's where the hope of Abul Fazl was broken, and he looks up in the heaven, that the voice echoes, Oh Abul Fazl, we haven't desired, we haven't granted your wish that the water reaches the children of Hussein, but you will become the Babul Hawaij for the children of Hussein to come. It is through your door all of the hajat will be given, O Abul Fazl. Look at the sacrifice of Abul Fazl and the sacrifice of children of Hussein, that he has become the Babul Hawaij for the children of Hussein to come till the day of judgment. And when that happens, the alam falls. When that alam falls, Hussein falls onto the ground, and Abul Fazl cries out loud, Oh Hussein, that my back is broken, my brother. And when that alam falls, the children start to lament, got anxious and worrying, what is going on? They cannot see the alam. And here, Hussein rides on the Zuljana and he says, Zuljana, I cannot see, but please take me to my brother. And Zuljana rides and he stands at a place, and Hussein throws himself on the ground. He says, Zuljana, where is my brother? Then Zuljana points out to the hand of Abul Fazl Abbas. Hussein picks up the hand of Abul Fazl and kisses it, and then rides back on Zuljana again and says, Zuljana, take me to my brother. Zuljana moves forward a bit more and stops again. Hussein gets down from the mount, takes the hands of Abul Fazl again. And then finally he reaches to Abul Fazl. When the dust settles, when the dust settles in the plain of Karbala, Hussein seeing, lamenting and crying. And the Rawi reports that the way Hussein cried brought tears in the eyes of the enemy. He places the head of Abul Fazl in the lap. And as soon as he places and cleans the blood, he sees Abul Fazl crying loudly. Then inquires, Oh my brother, why do you cry? Is it the pain and suffering that you go through? He says, No, that is not the case, my brother. I am looking at the plain of Karbala. I am thinking about in few hours you will be on the ground, and who will place your hand in the lap? You have attended to every shaheed. You have gone to the maqtal, to the ground. It was nothing but the Safa and Marwa for you, O Hussein. And now in few hours you will be on the ground. Who will place your head in the lap? Oh brother, do you have any wishes that I could fulfill? My brother, I have promised Sakina that I will bring water in the tents. Leave me in the banks of Furat. Do not take my body back. Oh my brother, when I came in this dunya, I saw your face first. And when I'm leaving this dunya, I want to see your face last. Can you please pull the arrow which is in my eye, which is not allowing me to see you? And here Hussein pulls the arrow and he looks at the face of Hussein. And in another report it says that the training of Ummul Baneen was so
that Abu al-Fazl always called Imam Hussein alayhi salam as master. He never called Imam Hussein alayhi salam as brother. And Hussein requests, "Oh my brother, will you fulfill my wish as well before you leave? You have always called me master in this life. Will you call me just once brother? I would like to hear this from you." And here Abu al-Fazl Abbas alayhi salam called Imam Hussein alayhi salam, "My brother, my brother, and my brother." And this is the moment that the spirit leaves. And Imam Hussein, trying to lift Abu al-Fazl Abbas, it cannot be taken. And finally he takes the alam of Abu al-Fazl Abbas alayhi salam. The children came out lamenting. Zainab came out lamenting. But she did something. Once she came out lamenting, she returns back to the ladies of Bani Hashim, to the ladies, and she said, "Zainab is really sorry because she had promised that your hijab will be protected. But now my Abbas is gone. There is no protection of your hijab." Ala lanatullah ala qawm al-zalimeen. Sayalaman ladheena zalamu ayyamun qalibin yanqalibun. Abu al-Fazl Abbas is the Bab al-Hawaij. Let's all together raise our hands 5 times. Recite this dua, which says, "Ya kashif al-karb an wajh al-Husayn, ikshif karbi bihaq akhik al-Husayn. Ya kashif al-karb an wajh al-Husayn, ikshif karbi bihaq akhik al-Husayn." We have problems, we have issues, we have people who are ill, people who have no houses, people who have deprived of basic needs in Iraq, in Syria, in different places, people who love Imam Hussein and Abu al-Fazl Abbas alayhi salam, people who desire and yearn to see the ziyarat and do the ziyarat of Abu Abdullah al-Hussein alayhi salam. Ya kashif al-karb an wajh al-Hussein, ikshif karbi bihaq akhik al-Hussein. Ya kashif al-karb an wajh al-Hussein, ikshif karbi bihaq akhik al-Hussein. The greatest of our karb, the greatest of our difficulty, is being deprived of Imam al-Asr, Imam al-Hujja alayhi salam. There are great tradition, there are great riwayat that reports that in the masayib of Abu al-Fazl al-Abbas alayhi salam, Imam al-Zamana is present. So let's all raise our hands and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let our tears, let our desires, let our hopes be some sort of ointment to the heart of the Imam of our time. Let our actions be some sort of hope and ointment to this broken heart of the Imam. Ya kashif al-karb an wajh al-Husayn, ikshif karbi bihaqi akhik al-Husayn. Abu al-Fazl al-Abbas alayhi salam, Ya Allah, 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 Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, Ya Muqallib al-Qulub. ثبت قلبي على دينك يا قاضي الحاجات يا كافي المهمات إنك على كل شيء قدير. رحم الله من قرأ الفاتحة لأرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات, especially the marhumin of the brothers and sisters who are present here, and also a surah Fatiha for the shifa of all of the mu'minin and mu'minat, and particularly who have served the deen and who have been injured, whose life have been difficult because of the jihad, because of the pains that they have taken, whether to protect the shrine of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, to protect the shrine of Sayyida Zainab from the hands of these terrorists. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them shifa-i kamil. A Fatiha with a loud salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allah.